It's hard to believe today is the first day of spring. Isn't that nice? Finally, spring is here, and it feels a little like spring, but it's good to know. I ran across this wonderful story from the autobiography of a man named Mahatma Gandhi. You may know him as the fellow from India who brought peace to that part of the world. Interestingly enough, during his student days, he started reading the Gospels. He read through all four Gospels, and he seriously considered converting to Christianity. He believed the teachings of Jesus would get rid of the caste system that was a part of India. You know, if you're not a part of this top caste, you're not worth much. And so this whole idea of being worthy or not worthy was a big deal to him. So one day he decided he'd go to a neighboring church. And he went to church on Sunday morning, and he comes in, and the usher at the door won't give him a seat, won't take him to a seat. He says, "Why don't you go worship with your own people?" And he ushered him out of the room. Interestingly enough, he went back and said, "If Christianity has caste differences just like the Hindus do, then I might as well remain a Hindu." Isn't that a shame? Because he saw this whole idea of "you're not worthy and you're not like us" as something wrong. And that's not what Christianity is all about. I remember very well while in Nashville, Tennessee, it was a Sunday morning and a young couple came to place membership. He was a nurse anesthesiologist. And she worked in the hospital welcoming people, admitting people, etc. The preacher got up and said, "It's nice to have this couple." Bang, and that was all was said. The next Sunday, a fellow who was the vice president of a bank came. And the preacher got up and went on and on and on about how great it was to have this noble man as a part of our assembly. I don't know about you, but that troubled me just a little. You know, the one fella who really ended up being a real important member in that church and an important member of my Bible class on Sunday, I taught the college class, but he came to the college class because he liked my Bible class. But he wasn't so important. The other fella who was a vice president was really important. Something is wrong somewhere when that's the case. In chapter 2, our man, James, is going to warn folks about something that he sees as a problem in the Jewish church, the Jewish community, a Christian community around him. These are folks who have become Christians, they're Jews, but apparently they're showing some prejudice. And that becomes important for him as he walks through this inconsistency in their religious life. Earlier, he's talked about folks who are hearers but not doers, and this is one of those hearers but not doers kind of things where they're kind of missing what matters. He also talks about folks who apparently don't take care of orphans and widows as they ought, and he's made a big deal of that. So we come to our text today. Here's the verse we read together a few moments ago. "My brethren, do not hold your faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ with an attitude of personal favoritism." I like the phrase. This is my New American Standard, personal favoritism. If you have an ESV, your ESV will say "with partiality." The good old King James Version, it says "with respect of persons." It's the NIV Reader's Version that really is designed for children in particular, says you need to treat everyone the same. But that's the whole idea, treating folks the same. And it's this favoritism that's there. And the word translated favoritism is literally lifting up your face. You know, when you look at one person, you lift up your face. When you look at the other folks, you kind of put your head down like, they don't matter so much. And he makes a big deal of this. This is really an Old Testament idea. In Leviticus chapter 19, verse 15, they're told, "You shall do no injustice in judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great, but you are to judge your neighbor fairly." Even back then, there's a real danger that some folks who are poor are going to be treated different than the folks who are rich. And so this inconsistency is a problem. It's something that God never does. You know, God causes the rain to come on the good and the bad. and the sun to shine on the good and the bad. And in fact, in the Sermon on the Mount, in the book of Matthew, Jesus will say, you need to be perfect like your Father in heaven is perfect. Doesn't mean sinless. He is that. But it means mature. You see, mature folks are going to treat all folks the same. No matter what their background is, no matter what their color is, no matter how rich they are or how poor they are, they should be treated the same. I love this text. It's an important one. He goes on to give his wonderful illustration. If a man comes to your assembly with a gold ring dressed in fine clothes, and there also comes a poor man in dirty clothes. Okay, it's Sunday morning, and in come two folks to worship on Sunday morning. One guy's a rich guy. He has a gold ring on his finger, indicating something of his wealth. And he has fine clothes, literally shining clothes. You know, he's got wonderful new suit, looks great. He's wonderful. And then in comes this poor guy in dirty clothes. I don't know that I would translate it dirty. The picture here is not that he doesn't wash his clothes, although if you're a poor guy back then, you know how many suits of clothes a typical person had back then? One. And so, you know, if you're going to wash your clothes, you got to sort of wash them while you got them on, because that's all you got. And so it could be dirty, but I think it probably ought to be translated something like shabby clothes. He comes in and he just doesn't have the nice outfit. He doesn't have a nice suit. He is in shabby clothes. And so they both come into the assembly. You pay special attention to the one who is wearing the fine clothes and you say, sit here in a good place. Okay, so he comes in and the usher says, you know, the best seats are for you. Come, why don't you sit in a good seat? And in fact, by the way, do you know where the best seats are? These ladies up front understand. The best seats are in the front. I know, you folks back in the back think the best seats are at the back. But in their culture, the best seat is at the front because that's where folks are going to be seen and that's where the folks of wealth are going to be sitting, up front. And so, come on down front and have a good seat. And so you're going to greet this person in a very noble way. Have a good place. And you say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit by my footstool. Okay, stand up right over there. You know, I'm not going to give you a seat. Stand up for worship. Or if you're going to sit down to my footstool. Sit down to my feet here, and that'll be a good place for you. You see how something is wrong in that assembly? Do we ever behave that way? You know, I think we make a big deal of saying, I'm not prejudiced, but sometimes our prejudice shows through in lots of ways. And we don't demonstrate that we really care about everybody. No matter what color they are, no matter what nationality they are, no matter what language they speak, no matter how well they're dressed, it doesn't make any difference. Because God has a place for them. God cares about them. And so you fix your eyes on the rich guy. That's an interesting phrase. You fix your eyes on him. You pay special attention to him. But to the other fellow, you don't even look at him. You just say, yeah, now sit over here. Sit down to my feet here, right here. That's a good place for you. Something is clearly wrong. And I think that's important for us to see. It's interesting. James asked this important question. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil motives? By the way, that's an interesting phrase. Have you not made distinctions? It's a phrase that is used earlier talking about doubting. It's not really doubting, but you're debating. Are you not debating where I'm going to put this person and how I'm going to treat this person because of his background? You're judging with evil motives. You want the rich guy because you think he's going to put more in the contribution on Sunday. You know, he's more likely to give the things I want to be given. This poor fella probably won't be able to give much. And so, maybe he's not that important. You see the difficulty with that kind of church? That's not the kind of church we are, and thank goodness that's not the case. But it's indeed important for us to see. It doesn't make any difference what color you are, what background you have. We welcome you, and we should welcome you. That's what it's all about. He goes on to talk about God and the poor. Listen, my beloved brethren, did not God choose the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? You see, God has chosen poor folks. Interestingly enough, when I started going to Romania now almost 30 years ago, 28 years ago or 29 years ago, it was interesting because we were winning lots and lots of folks. The culture back then was really poor and almost everybody was poor. And so lots of folks would respond to the message. Now that folks are richer and wealthier, it's not as easy to win folks to the Lord. It's easier to win poor folks to the Lord than rich folks. It's still that way today. I hate to tell you that, but it is. You know, it's more likely that those are the folks who are going to respond because they see their need and they understand it. But you'll notice he chose the poor of this world to be rich in faith. The church that he's dealing with is primarily made up of poor Jewish folks who may have been cut off from their own culture. Because since you're not a Jew and worshiping as a Jew, we don't want to do business with you. And so they may have found real difficulty because of that. But God has promised those folks, to those who love him, who put him at the top of their list, they're the folks that he's chosen. But you have dishonored the poor man. Here's this poor guy who comes in and you've dishonored him. Something is wrong with that kind of church. Is it not the rich who oppress you and personally drag you to court? Now, it seems to me like you're really honoring the wrong folks, especially in their culture. You see, the rich folks are going to dishonor you, and they're going to drag you into court to try to get more money out of you, and they're going to blaspheme the fair name by which you've been called. Not only are they treating you badly, but they're saying bad things about Jesus. It's the name by which you've been called. By the way, this is one of those places where the only time you get that kind of language used is here and in Acts chapter 15, which is the letter that James writes to the church. And he'll talk about the name by which you've been called. And it's the name you've been called. See, you've been called Christians. You've been called by the name of Christ. You are his people, and they're making fun of that. Why are you treating rich folks better than you're treating poor folks? It seems to me like you've got something wrong here. There is something that is misplaced in this whole behavior. If, however, you are fulfilling the royal law according to Scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you're doing well. I think he realizes that a lot of folks are going to say, well, we're treating those rich folks the way we're treating them is because, we're told to. You know, you're supposed to love your neighbor as yourself, and hey, he's one of my neighbors, and I'm going to treat him well. But he's going to say, you know, I think you're missing something. It's really interesting. That passage, which, by the way, comes from Leviticus 19, love your neighbor as yourself, they don't read the whole chapter. In that chapter, interestingly enough, your neighbor you treat royally. But do you know if you've got a sojourner who's in the land who's not one of you, you're supposed to treat him the same way? In that same text. They only look at the part of it that makes sense to them. I'm treating this guy well because he's my neighbor. He's somebody I want to have in church with me. He's somebody special. And he says, you know, you're missing something and it's important. If you show partiality, you are committing sin. Partiality is sin. Did you see that? That's a sin. That is sin, and are convicted by the law as transgressors. You are a breaker of the law. Whoever keeps the whole law yet stumbles in one point, is he not guilty of it all? You claim to be keeping the law. But if you keep part of the law and not the other part of the law, you're still a lawbreaker. He goes on to say, for he who has said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not commit murder. If you don't commit adultery but commit murder, you are a transgressor of the law. Don't you realize you break any part of it? You're breaking the law? I know you're treating this guy who's so noble well because he's your neighbor and he's important. But do you know when you treat the poor guy differently, you're still breaking the law. And breaking the law is breaking the law. And you need to understand that. So speak and act as those who are judged by the law of liberty. You need to speak, talk to folks, rich or poor, and act to folks, rich or poor, because you're judged by the law of liberty. By the way, law here I don't think is a law in that sense, but maybe principle, maybe the principle of liberty. You've gained freedom in Christ Jesus, and you realize that that blessing is available to anybody and everybody. You welcome them all, and they all become a part of you, playing favorites. Do we ever do that? You know, we say, oh, I don't show favoritism, but I think sometimes we really do. You see, mercy, compassion, is what he calls us to show compassion and mercy for all. And I think this is a wonderful text. It calls us as the people of God to be the people of God. And so in our text, he really is calling us to understand that. We are indeed God's people. May we show that wonderful grace that he's shown to us, that unmerited favor, and may we show the same kind of favor to others who come to worship with us. That's who we need to be as a church, and I think that's who we are as a church. I think we're pretty good at that, but we need to continue to realize the blessings that are ours in Christ Jesus. We're going to sing a song as an invitation song now, that David is going to bring us, to lead us in. And it's important for us to realize the wonderful blessings that are ours and to live our lives accordingly. Perhaps you've never confessed Jesus as Lord and you've never become one of His. And now's an opportunity for you to do that. But for the rest of us, as we go home, we need to think of the responsibility that we have to others. No matter what color, no matter what race, no matter what background, whether rich or poor, they all have an opportunity to respond to this wonderful message of God.